Happy Thanksgiving.
Thank you.
to cast away the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Now in the time of this mortal life in which your Son, Jesus Christ, came to visit us in great humility, that in the last day, when he shall come again in his glorious majesty to judge both the living and the dead, we may rise to the life immortal, through him who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated for the reading.
A reading from Jeremiah. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will fulfill the promise I made to the house of Israel and to the house of Judah. In those days and at that time, I will cause a righteous branch to spring up from David, to spring up for David, and he shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. In those days, Judah will be saved, and Jerusalem will live in safety. And this is the name by which it will be called: the Lord is our righteousness. The word of the Lord. Let us read Psalm 25, verses 1 through 9, in a half verse, as printed in your bulletin. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. My God, I put my trust in you.
Let
none who look to you be put to shame. Show me your ways, O Lord. Lead me in your truth and teach me. Remember, O Lord, your compassion and love.
For they are everlasting.
Remember not the sins of my youth and my transgressions.
Remember me according to your love and for the sake of your goodness, O Lord.
Gracious and upright is the Lord.
Therefore he teaches sinners in his way.
He guides the humble in doing right.
And teaches his way to the lowly.
All the paths of the Lord are love and faithfulness.
To those who keep his covenant and his testimonies.
A reading from 1 Thessalonians. How can we thank God enough for you in return for all the joy that we feel before our God because of you? Night and day we pray most earnestly that we may see you face to face and restore whatever is lacking in your faith. Now, may our God and Father himself and our Lord Jesus direct our way to you. And may the Lord make you increase and abound in love for one another and for all, just as we abound in love for you. And may he so strengthen your hearts in holiness that you may be blameless before our God and Father at the coming of our Lord Jesus with all his saints. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Follow the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said, there will be signs in the sun, the moon, and stars, and on the earth distress among nations, confused by the roaring of the sea and the waves. People will faint from fear and foreboding of what is coming upon the world. The powers of the heavens will be shaken, and they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. Now when these things begin to take place, stand up and raise your heads, because your redemption is drawing near. Then he told them a parable. Look at the fig tree and all the trees. As soon as they sprout leaves, You can see for yourself and know that summer is already near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that the kingdom of God is near. Truly I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. Be on guard so that your hearts are not weighed down with dissipation and drunkenness and the worries of this life, and that day hits you unexpectedly like a trap, for it will come upon all who live on the face of the whole earth. Be alert at all times, praying that you may have the strength to escape all these things that will take place and to stand before the Son of Man. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please be seated. Today, from the reading from Jeremiah, we hear, I will cause the righteous branch to spring up for David, and he shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. So where and when will we see this victory of justice and righteousness? Relatives of the 9 black victims of the Charleston church shooting 6 years ago gave very emotional statements during the initial court appearance of the perpetrator, Dylan Roof. Some of them broke into sobs as one after another they told the man suspected of killing their loved ones that they forgave him. I will never talk or see my mother again, the daughter of the 70-year-old Ethel Lance, one of those 9 people killed in the massacre, said, but I forgive you, and I have mercy on your soul. You hurt me. You hurt a lot of people. God forgives you. I forgive you. The bright and clear lines between evil and justice and righteousness were unmistakable in that case. Dylan Roof was that evil. Those lines are not always so easily drawn. In Brunswick, Georgia, this past week, as the first verdict was read by the judge, that verdict was that Travis McMichael was guilty of malice murder of Ahmaud Arbery. And a cheer from Arbery's father was heard in the courtroom. People embraced and cried as deputies called for order, and onlookers in the room next door tried to contain their excitement. There was some great relief in that courtroom. There was also some shock. Travis McMichael's father, Gregory McMichael, was also found guilty of felony murder and 7 other charges, and their neighbor, Woody Bryan, who recorded the video of the killing, was found guilty of 3 counts of felony murder and then 3 other charges. Although Arbery's mother, Wanda Cooper Jones, sobbed and repeated, we finally got justice. Also inside that courtroom, Travis McMichael mouthed, I love you, to his mother, Lee McMichael, who was crying, and she heard the verdict against her son. And Travis McMichael's lawyer said that Travis is a good man, a stalwart man, after the verdict was read. His lawyer says he understood the potential consequences of all of this. Whatever he was feeling that day, Travis McMichael was holding him to himself. And his lawyer tells us he honestly believed that what he had done was the right thing to do. Carolyn Ruff, another person, came down from Chicago and said she traveled to Brunswick, Georgia from Kenosha, Wisconsin, where she had watched the proceedings and the trial of Kyle Rittenhouse, the 17-year-old who shot 2 people and severely injured another. And that Carolyn Ruff, who came down from Chicago, said she thought Kyle Rittenhouse should have been convicted for the shooting and killing of those 2 men. Standing in front of the table, she said she believed it was her duty to be there to see if justice could be meted out in this new case. The Michaels and Brody Bryan all will face life in prison. So we know that from that one incident of violence on their part, 4 men were not present at their Thanksgiving tables this past week. So it's really no wonder that in a recent poll, Nearly two-thirds of those polled said they were hoping that politics would not be discussed at the Thanksgiving table. Discord, perhaps, could be avoided. Well, this past week was a time of Thanksgiving, and it's about gratitude. For some, it may seem a little harder this year. If you are one of those for whom it's harder, I hope that this might help you. Gratitude in the face of upset is one of the most powerful and transformational changes that can take place in us. I would say, however, that the change that we are seeking right now is actually even outside of or beyond that gratitude in the way that we have been used to defining that term. I suspect what we are really searching for is a state of stillness, a state of calm. It's a state of neutrality in love. I mean that this version of love has no conditions. There are no attachments. It is simply pure. So in this moment, try moving into that higher version of yourself, into the part of you that continues to live in the eternal, in the infinite. In this moment, see through the eyes of that version of you and see with intention what is actually in your life right now. See that there is a higher appointment occurring for you and for all of us. You may just get an inkling of a greater unfolding. You will likely get the sense that there is more to it than you've been seeing. And you can hit that deeper place. And then gratitude is an offshoot of that deep place. In this new energy of Thanksgiving, your life can change. New energies can come. And they can come even easily and obviously to you when you least expect it. I would suggest that hymns are often useful for that purpose. My Thanksgiving Day was different for me this year, different from any of my past 70 years. For the first time in 70 years of living on this earth, I was not in the midst of my own family. But later in the day, at Thanksgiving dinner, I was in the midst of others who had vastly different views from me on significant matters of race, injustice, inequality, indifference, and our nation's history. It was helpful to me that the first 8 hours of my Thanksgiving Day, from the time I woke up until the time I went to that friend's home for the afternoon Thanksgiving dinner, those 8 hours had been spent alone with God, listening to some of my favorite hymns. I did no other tasks, no other chores, called no people, did not look at my phone, did not get on my computer. I was just trying during all those 8 hours to feel closer to God and feel God's presence. This was something I'd never done before. I was thankful for the lack of busyness that day. By the way, when I went to the Thanksgiving dinner with those people who saw things very differently from I understood that God is also the God who is the God of those same people with whom I spent the afternoon. But listening to my hymns during the first part of the day helped quiet my soul so that I could listen intently to others' views and try to understand where they came from, no matter from whence those views came, and no matter whether I agreed with them or not. Many of them I did not agree with, but we found things that we had in common. The simple fact that I felt God's presence made it all easier and better for me. So here are two of those favorite hymns. Joyce's ears are perking up. First is one that we heard from our choir before, sung very beautifully. It is Well With My Soul. I had that on my iPhone, and I listened to it over and over that day. So the question comes, are things well with our souls? Another of my favorite hymns is one that may be less familiar to you, but it does appear in our hymnal. It's one that I remember from my childhood, and often things from one childhood kind of stick to the walls of our brains, like this one did for me. It's a hymn written in 1835, "Just As I Am." Here are a few of the verses. "Just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou didst bid me come to thee, O Lamb of God, come. Just as I am, though tossed about with many a conflict and many a doubt, fightings and fears within and without, O Lamb of God, I come. Just as I am, thou wilt receive, wilt welcome, pardon, cleanse, relieve, because thy promise I believe, O Lamb of God, I come. Just as I am, thy love unknown has broken every barrier down. Now to be thine yea, thine alone, O Lamb of God, I come." Christian community is a place where we keep the flame of that hope alive among us. And we take it seriously so that it can grow and become stronger in each of us and make our community stronger as well. That is how we dare to say that God is a God of love, even when we see hatred all around us. That is why we can claim that God is a God of life, even when we see death and destruction and agony. We say it together. We affirm it in each other, waiting together, nurturing what has already begun, and expecting its fulfillment. So when will Jesus return to make everything better? No one has a suitable answer, although people often have tried to come up with one, and they've turned out to be wrong. So I think we would do well to live according to a small prayer as part of an evening service called Compline. It's in our prayer book. It comes from the Anglican and Catholic traditions. It uses these words: "Guide us waking, O Lord, and guard us sleeping, that awake we may watch with Christ, and asleep we may rest in peace." What can it mean to watch with Christ this Advent? Among other things, it means we are to see the world through Christ's eyes, which means watching for people in need, watching for evils to counter, and watching for hunger to alleviate. So even if we don't know in any detail what troubles await us, we have Jesus' own word that troubles will in fact find us. But that's not the end of the story. It's not the end of the story. Instead, we live in hope because Christ, God incarnate, has overcome the world and overcome death, has gone through the darkness of Calvary, and has defeated it. So in this Advent season, we engage in sort of an active waiting. We don't just sit in silence, although some silence and meditation on eternal matters could be good for all of us, like it was for me on Thanksgiving Day. Even as we wait for the joy of Christmas morning, we already know that the baby in the manger came bearing the gift of hope. In fact, it's when we travel through darkness in our lives that hope comes most to life. It's when we feel abandoned by God that we must seize that hope and insist on God's promises, and that they are real, and that they can be counted upon. "Just as I am, thou wilt receive, will welcome, pardon, cleanse, and relieve, because thy promise I believe." Let us stand and affirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God,
the Father Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth.
He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, and bore the scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of God. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom have a hand. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, and the Father and the Son and his worship and glorified. He has spoken to the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge all the baptism of believers and sinners. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The prayers of the people are formed for, found in your leaflet. Let us pray for the church and for the world. Grant, Almighty God, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. Lord, in your mercy, guide the people of this land and of all the nations in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give us all a reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others and to your honor and glory. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bless all whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation.
I ask your prayers for the family of Libby Bristow, family of Varian England, for the family of Ginger Horvath, Molly and Lily Hoppy, and for Marie DeLuca.
Lord, in your mercy, we commend to your mercy all who have died, that your will for them may be fulfilled, and we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, hear the prayers of thy people, and what we have asked faithfully, grant that we may obtain effectually to the glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, for what we have done and what we have left undone. We have not loved our neighbors of our heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us. We may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen.
Mighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
May the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Peace, guys.
Walk in love,
sleep on the track. Yeah.
Oh,
your word spoken through the prophets, and above all, in the Lord made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate through the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil, and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Hey, eat. This is my body which is given to you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took a cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember
his death. We proclaim his resurrection. We await his coming glory.
And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in sacrifice, that we may be acceptable to him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection unto your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where with Luke and all your saints we may enter into the everlasting inheritance of your sons and daughters, through Jesus Christ our Lord, firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are both the same.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Hallelujah. Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Hallelujah.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world.
Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world.
Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world.
Grant us peace.
The gifts of God, the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you. Feed on it in your hearts, I say, with thanksgiving.
us, and the members of your Son's Jesus Christ. May it fed us with the spiritual food and the sacrament of body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, through the Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you this day and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated. Wanted to let you know that a lot of pledges are coming in. They're coming in very nicely at a good pace, and I really appreciate you all taking to heart things I've told you in the past about how our church needs to be sort of rebuilding from where we were. And I'm so thankful that some of you were able to increase your pledges even over what you gave last year. You always give so generally of yourself and your time and your money and your energy. So all of that is very welcome for all of us. We have a vestry meeting this coming Tuesday night on Zoom at 6:30. And we're going to be talking about a lot of different things. But one of them is going to be talking, at least preliminarily, about a budget for the coming year. So we'll be looking at what we have and the pledges and where we can put them to our best use. So that will be a very important meeting. Next week on Sunday, we are going to do the greening of the church. We're doing it earlier this year than normal because we have a piano recital in here the following week. So any of you who can remain behind after the service next Sunday, please plan on doing that. And many hands make small work, so it'll be great if we can have a few of you here to do that. Also wanted to let you know that there is a session that happens via Zoom also, or in person if you would like to, and I'll let Mary tell you about that.
So Ken Citarella, who's the deacon at St. James Church in North Salem, he's offered, the first one was this morning, two sessions for an Advent discussion group, and he sends out readings ahead of time and some questions to think about. And then we get together to discuss them. And I joined via Zoom this morning, and there were probably six or eight people from his parish there in the room. But it was very well run, and he's a dynamic speaker. So if anyone's interested, there's one more session next Sunday. You can either join in person or via Zoom. It's at 8:30, from 8:30 to 9:30. And if anyone is interested, I can always set it up downstairs. I'll bring my laptop. We can do a Zoom from downstairs. Or if you want to join in person, that's fine too. But if you're interested, let me know so I can share the Zoom link with you and any materials that Ken sends out.
Thank you, Mary. Any other announcements? Okay, I guess we're ready for our hymn.
Our closing hymn is number 640 in your hymnal. Watchmen tell us of the night, number 640.
Thank you.
apologize.